Welcome home to Undeserved Favor Ministry. We are making Jesus, God's love and grace, known to the world. A blessed Sunday, church, and welcome to our online service. We're so glad you could join us today because we are going to celebrate yet again the life that Jesus has given us, a life that He gave His life up for, so that today you and I can live a life that is free, live a life that is more abundant, live a life that is greatly blessed, highly favored, deeply loved, a life of a winner, a life that is blessed to be a blessing. Amen. Let us prepare for our praise and worship with a prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and loving Father Abba, thank you. It is truly a privilege to be able to praise and worship our loving Savior Jesus Christ today, to just be able to sit at His feet amidst the disorder, the chaos, and the crisis that's happening in the world today. Thank you for this opportunity to do this one thing, just as Mary did amidst the hustle and bustle of Martha, to just be able to soak in the beauty of Christ, to focus on Him, to be able to sing about the things that He has done for us. The King of glory, the King above all kings, may you be glorified in our praise and worship. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Come on, church, let's sing about God's amazing grace, His unfailing love, the life that He has given us. Come on. Come on, church, let's sing about God's amazing love, amazing grace, unfailing love. Let's sing about all that He has done for us. Let's sing about who He is in our life. Get ready to lift your voices.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos? Come on.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphans a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
For all that you've done for me. Just do this one thing, just praise and worship you, to sit at your feet, to just soak in your beauty, your wonder and your power, Jesus, to just seek you constantly. As I seek you, I find myself. As I seek you, I find everything that I'll ever need. I find everything that I ever want and I'll ever desire. So I continue to seek you, the kingdom of God, his righteousness.
Thank you.
shall be added unto you.
Jesus, I'll continue to seek you at your word. Continue to seek your kingdom, your righteousness, your beauty, your wonder, your power. I'll continue to do this one thing, to just seek you. For as I seek you, I find you. And as I find you, I find all that I am in you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen.
Church, we have now come to our communion. Please make sure that you have your communion elements with you. Brothers and sisters, this is a special moment because God has given us the opportunity to be reminded again about His great love for us. And we're also being reminded that with God, life is awesome. So brothers and sisters, the bread and the cup of wine that you're holding right now is a reminder where you are settled and have peace and rest. Because God, through Jesus Christ, gave up His body, His blood, and His life for you. So remember on that night before Jesus Christ was betrayed, He took the bread, gave the bread to His disciples. He broke it after giving thanks and said, "Take this bread and eat it, for this is my body, which will be broken for you. Do this as often and remembrance of me." And then He took the cup, gave the cup to His disciples, and said, "Take this cup and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, and it shall be shed for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often in remembrance of me." So brothers and sisters, as we do this breaking of bread and drinking of the cup, we are declaring the Lord's death, and we are confirming that Jesus Christ died for us. And on the third day, He rose from the dead, victorious over the powers of death. And that means that His wounds with His broken body, you and I are healed. So let's now raise the bread, everybody. Lord Jesus, you are my Savior. Your broken body made me whole. By your wounds, I am healed. I receive it right now, healing, wholeness for my entire body. From my head down to my toes, I am made whole. I am healed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Amen. Let me eat the bread. Okay, let's raise the cup and declare with faith. Lord Jesus, your perfect blood washed away all my sins perfectly. So today, I receive your righteousness by your blood, and I receive the life of favor that comes from you alone. Thank you, Jesus. I love you too. Amen. You may drink the cup. God bless you, brothers and sisters.
We know that after the worship, you're even more excited to give your tithes and offering. But please be reminded that the giving of tithes and offering comes by a revelation that Jesus is truly alive in our lives. It is an act of faith and a privilege. So please do not feel obliged if you do not have that revelation yet. Be excited because God will reveal it to you in His perfect time. For those who already have that revelation, and when you act out of faith, then there is nothing that will stop the floodgates of heaven to open, as your Father in heaven has prepared everything for you. If you intend to electronically give your tithes and offering through online fund transfer, please indicate your name in the remarks field so that Pastor Ronel can personally pray for you. With this, we invite you to raise your hand, your mobile gadget, or your tithe envelope. For prayer, let us pray. Our most gracious and loving Father, you are indeed a good God. Your most generous ways never run out and never wear out. You give a seed for our bread and much more, so that we can also be generous in every way, producing within us. Great praise to you, O God. We rest assured that you will reveal the message of tithing to those who are seeking you in it. Thank you for the privilege to tithe and offer today. Continue to honor and glorify yourself through our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What up, church? Are you ready to train in life today? We have an amazing message for you today as together we learn how to reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. And today's Valentine's Day, and so we extend our love from Undeserved Favor Ministry to you and to your family. God bless you and may God's love ever be abundant in your life today. Amen. And it's so timely because our testimony today is about two couples from Undeserved Favor Ministry. Let's take a read. This is our testimony of how God is able to restore not only a relationship, but the quality of a relationship. My husband and I have been with Undeserved Favor Ministry for 5 years now, but I can say that I took flight first in grace. I knew grace first and invited my husband in. Somehow, I noticed I matured spiritually first, but I really prayed that he too would have the same revelation and he would enjoy the life I was enjoying in Christ. Back then, I have been noticing how he would secretly play mobile games when he is resting from work. At first, I would remind him that he was better than that and he should focus more on learning that would build him up. I have to admit, I was really uncomfortable until it came to a point that I would notice that he was being moody. God revealed to me in a vision the games he has been playing. The following day, God prompted me to do a couple devotion with my husband, and I just started ministering. This was back then when Pastor Ron preached about Jesus' word brings peace. I reminded my husband how the enemy puts thoughts in our minds through worldly things like violent games. If we're not grounded in the word of God, even these simple games would influence our thinking. In that same week, he had a life-changing experience where the word of God and not the tactics of mobile games got him through. Amen. And one time he told me, "I am sorry, my love. I have a new first love now. His name is Jesus. Praise God." That was one of the best moments in my life. Today, he's always the first one to do the devotion, and I would hear him minister to his family. Praise God. Looking back, I realized God has already prepared this life for the both of us. We just had to decide if we were to hold on to His word or to the trappings of the world. Well, to live a truly quality life and enjoy a quality relationship, It's an obvious choice of God's word for us. Amen, amen. Praise God for that awesome testimony. And it's amazing and it's so true that truly by God's grace and through His love, that relationships can be restored. And not just the relationship, but even the quality of their relationship. Amen. Praise God. And that is why today we're here to learn how to reign in life through Jesus Christ. And so with that, let's all together do our declaration. In Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. One more time. In Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. Amen and amen. And why can we reign in life today? Is it because of our works or our efforts or our goodness? No. It's because of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ lives in us. Amen. And so together, church, we declare this one more time. In Christ, I am greatly blessed. I am highly favored. I am deeply loved. I am a winner. I am blessed to be a blessing. Amen and amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And so with that, church, as we go on to our message, let's open with a prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this awesome day that you have given us. We thank you, Father, that today we get to celebrate Valentine's Day surrounded with your love. We know, Father, how much you love us, that you gave Jesus Christ to die on the cross for our sins. And so today, Father, we can live the life of abundance, of amazing victory, because of Jesus Christ who has won it all. And so today, Father, as we receive the word from our pastor today, thank you, Father, that you have blessed him and given him the words of wisdom that's going to bless us and will train us to reign in life. We pray, Father, that you ready our hearts to receive the word today, that the word may grow in our hearts, and that it may bring forth fruit in its time. We thank you, Father, for all these things, for being so good to us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Be blessed, church.
Blessed Sunday, brothers and sisters. Thank you for joining us today in the Undeserved Favor Ministry Sunday Worship. And I trust that you've experienced the presence of our God as we sung, no, the songs of worship and thanksgiving and praises to our God. And of course, as we partook of the communion, you know what it means, and continue growing in understanding the meaning of the communion. And of course, the tithes and offering, no, which especially addresses our how we look at our finances, you know, and even how we use the seeds that God has given us. And so, brothers and sisters, it's amazing that God has really given us all this time, you know, His revelation, His amazing word of truth, so that we can be so equipped to live life to the full. Trust, brothers and sisters, that God wants you to live a full and abundant life. He wants you to live the life that Jesus gave you, and that's our theme for this year. Amen. Praise God. And we've been learning all these past Sundays about the very importance of this law of faith. You see, brothers and sisters, some Christians, they don't understand that there's such a thing as a law of faith, no? And we've been learning about that God, no, through Jesus Christ, has already provided everything. Nothing was left undone. That's why on the cross, Jesus said, finished. No, He shouted, finished, because He already finished the work. And take note, brothers and sisters, God in His complete knowledge of everything here on earth, He has already anticipated, has already has seen ahead of time all our needs, wants, even desires, and whatever we will pray for. And He's already provided and anticipated all these things. So that's a very important truth that you need to remember. So you don't pray like begging God as if God was unable to anticipate, no? Or God was caught in a surprise where you have a need and He has not anticipated that. No, my friend, the truth is God, no, has anticipated everything. That's why when Jesus said it is finished, it is finished. Okay, so it's a done deal, no? And Jesus provided everything, anticipated all our needs, wants, desires, even our prayers today. And that is why, brothers and sisters, you have nothing to worry about. And yet, God wants you to have revelation of how His kingdom operates, how the spiritual life operates. And We've learned in the past Sundays that there's such a thing as the law of faith. And we need to abide by this law of faith, like electricity, like gravity. No, if you go against these laws, these principles that God has already established, you will only crush yourself into it. It's like putting your hand into an electric outlet, no? And regardless how sincere, how obedient you are, or how much you've read the Bible, if you put your hands a live wire or touch a live wire, definitely you will be electrocuted, and that's nothing personal, no? It's a law that no one should touch that live wire. So that's the same thing with us, brothers and sisters, in the spirit. No, God wants us to already live life to the full here on earth, and we've been given life in the spirit. You see, spiritual life is higher or above the life, this flesh, life in the flesh. And that's why he who is in me is greater than he who is in the world, as the word of God says. Because Christ is in us, who is far greater, far above anything on this earth. And that's why in the book of Romans, no, it says there that the word of God says that you and I reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. And it's a gift that all we need to do is believe and receive. And this gift of righteousness is that which will bring us to this favored life through Jesus Christ. No? And so, brothers and sisters, as we continue to learn, if you notice, God wants us equipped because He has given us everything. And yet, for some Christians, they don't know. No? Or for some of us, we don't know how to operate, no? How to use this power that's already in us. Because Christ is already in us. He has given us His life. And that means His authority, His power is in us. And all we need to do is use it. Now, the big question, brothers and sisters, is do you know how to use it? Okay? So, let me go straight to the Word. And I will show you, no, that really, you have your part. So, the title of this message today is, Do Your Part. We have a part to do. Okay? God's part is His grace. He has given us His undeserved favor. No, given us His grace through the finished work of Jesus Christ. Now, all God asks is our part, and that is to believe, have faith, and act on what we believe. Do your part, brothers and sisters. And that's our part. Okay, that's our role, no, in this bigger scheme of things in this world. No? God wants us to live a full and abundant life. He has given everything. Now this time, do your part, my friend. And that's why I hope you realize in Christianity, no, to live a full and abundant life in Christ, to live in Christ, not to live the life that Jesus gave. You cannot be lazy. You cannot be a lazy Christian. You cannot be a Christian who is just unconcerned or, you know, just whatever will be. No, that cannot be, my friend. Because God does not dictate upon you His grace. God does not force you, no, to live the full and abundant life, although He has given it already. In fact, He has given it to the world. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. So, He has given everything. And yet, to those who believe in Him, of course, we have the favor, no? Undeserved favor. It's called grace. But again, my friend, we have our part to believe, to have faith, and act on what we believe. In other words, faith without works is dead. Okay? We've learned that in the past Sundays. And so, do your part, okay? So, that's why the title of this message is Do Your Part. So, let me go straight, no, to the Word of God, and I will show you, we will start in the Old Testament, and then we go to the New Testament, okay? And of course, there's a difference, no? The difference is the same Word of God, but the difference, what's the difference? What do you think? Of course, obviously, Jesus, okay? The big difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant is Jesus. And so, that's what we will see, no? But again, the Word of God, even in the Old Testament, is equally powerful and true. And yet, the favor of God is upon us through Jesus Christ in the New Covenant or the New Testament. So let me go straight to the Word. I'm so excited to share with you this revelation, and I pray and I trust that you will receive this so that you can apply this in your life, because it's already a done deal. It's a given for the taking, for your taking, my friend. Okay, so let's dive into this very important truth. I'll show you first in 2 Kings chapter 4. No? Here's a story here where it's a time during the time of Elisha the prophet. Now, Elisha had many students. No? He had he would go to different places in Israel and he would have students. And these students would learn from him, and the students would be the one to also teach, no? Others about the truth in God's word, and as they were taught by Elisha. And so here's a case where this particular student died, and the wife came to Elisha, no, asking for help. Let me read that in verse. Let's start with verse 1 of 2 Kings chapter 4. Now a woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, "Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor has come to take my two children to be his slaves." Oh my, no, this is a terrible situation, no? The husband died, and obviously they had many debts, no? They had creditors. And unfortunately, because the husband died, the creditors are now coming after the children as payment, no? And the creditors will make the children as slaves in payment of the debt. Wow, that's terrible, my friend. So what happened? The wife came to Elijah for help, because anyway, this husband was a student of Elijah. No, Elisha was the prophet here, the teacher. So let me continue. Verse 2. So Elisha said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?" And she said, "Your servant has nothing in the house except a jar of oil." Wow. Nothing. What happened? You see, I hope you realize this, brothers and sisters. There are Christians. I don't know if you can relate, but there are Christians who are like this, no? They love the Lord. They believe in Jesus Christ. They read the Bible. They go to church. They read and even meditate. They obey God, and yet they live a very difficult life. And in this case, no, a student of the prophet, and yet the family is in poverty. And they had nothing but a jar of oil. And yet, okay, you see, my friend, while this is a sad story, but it will not end sad, okay? Because when God is involved, victory is guaranteed. Okay, so what happened here again? Verse 3, then Elisha said, "Go, borrow containers elsewhere for yourself. Empty containers from all your neighbors. Do not get too few." Wow. What an instruction, no? You see that? Go, borrow containers and empty containers, and do not get too few. No, dili gamay lang, no? What for? No? What is this for, no? When in fact she has nothing but a jar of oil. So let's continue reading in verse 4. "Then you shall come in." So this is the further instruction, no? If you notice in verse 3, she was instructed, go borrow, okay? Containers, many containers, okay? So if you notice there, Elisha is asking her to do something, okay? Now, brothers and sisters, before we continue, I hope you realize this, no? Here's a scenario where Elisha was, in a way, the leader of the husband. The wife being left, no, by the husband with the kids, and her being threatened by the creditors, came to Elisha. So it's like, you know, I don't know if you can relate, but if you're a leader, no, and one of your like either probably employees or students or somebody, no, or if you're the head of the family, or if you have brothers and sisters and you're the eldest, something like that, no, and the others would come to you for help, and this is what happened, no. So it's not easy, because if you were Elisha, it seems like, you know, the wife was saying, help, no? I mean, at least be responsible, Prophet Elisha, no? I mean, this person was your student. And it was not easy. This is how I see it, no? The wife was actually making Elisha responsible. Parang, like, Elisha, come on, do something about this, no? Anyway, you're the man of God. And sometimes I can relate, because, you know, being a pastor, you know, some people would come to me and, you know, like, treat me like, you know, pastor, you should do something about this, or pastor, you should, you know, encourage us, pastor, or pastor, you should be, you know, giving us, you know, guidance and instruction. And that's a responsibility. And I want you to see this, no? Because instead of Elisha, no, taking responsibility, did you notice in verse 2? Look at what Elisha did in verse 2. Elisha said, what shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house? What do you have in the house? And if you notice in verse 3, after that question, what do you have in the house? And the woman, of course, said, I only have a jar of oil. He said, go, borrow, okay? So you will find that instead of taking the responsibility, no, Elisha actually guided, no, or instructed the woman, the wife, to do something. Okay, take a hint. God wants you to do something with your situation. Now I'm giving you a head already, no, a hint already of what's going to happen, especially in the new covenant, no, with Jesus. But here's the thing. With the finished work of Jesus Christ, He has already given you everything. Do something. Okay? If you have a problem, do something. So, let me continue, no? So, Elisha gave the instruction, do something, no? Go borrow containers, plenty of containers. And then, of course, if you look at here in verse 4, then you shall come in and shut the door behind you and your sons, and pour into all these containers, and you shall set aside what is full. Verse 5. So she left him and shut the door behind her. Okay, so she did it, and her sons. So with her sons, they went and did as instructed. They began bringing the containers to her, and she poured the oil. When the containers were full, she said to her son, bring me another container. But he said to her, there are no more containers. Then the oil stopped. Verse 7, so she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons can live on the rest. Wow. Brothers and sisters, what happened here? Okay, very quickly, I'll show you. Elijah gave her an instruction, she followed. No? Instead of like begging Elisha for help, probably Elisha could help her one way or another, but Elisha said, thought it would not be enough, no? So instead of Elisha giving what he had, Elisha instructed the wife to what? To actually make the miracle happen in her life. No? So that's what exactly happened, no? So here, you will find that the wife followed the instruction. She did her part. You have to do your part, my friend. And when she did her part, look at here again. She poured in verse 5, she left him, shut the door. Okay, now let me emphasize this, shut the door. Now, why shut the door? Why not? Just, you know, you have all the containers, without taking it from their probably neighbor's houses. And she will just go around and bring her, because she had her jar of oil, diba? And she could have like probably went to the different houses with all their empty containers and just started pouring out. Why bring the containers to their house and shut the door? Okay, very important note. Okay? Shut the door. It's actually saying in application, my friend, that we need to shut the door from people who are unbelieving, who do not believe. Because, you see, it's very, very crucial, no? I don't know if you have experienced this, but there are, you started to believe on something, you know, based on the Word of God. And somehow, when you share this to someone probably important to you, a loved one, somebody you care for, and because they don't have the same faith as you have on the Word of God, they start to put unbelief in your mind. And sooner or later, you lose that faith. So, very important note for everybody. Once you start believing on something, shut the door to people who are unbelieving, who do not believe with you. Now, granting, of course, that the word that you are believing is the Word of God, okay, in Christ. Huh? That's beneficial to you. You have that? Be careful. Shut the door to people who are unbelieving because they will only discourage you. If you're believing for a miracle of healing, then make sure that you only talk about this with people who also believe. No? Don't mention this to people who don't even give or don't even care, no, about your miracle or about the Word of God. If you're believing for a financial breakthrough, the same thing, no? Make sure that you don't expose yourself to people who don't believe in the Word of God on financial breakthrough, because they will only discourage you and probably bring you to logic, no? And reasoning. And of course, God's power is beyond reason. Amen? And that's why, thanks be to God, because, you know, logic, if you only operate on logic, there is no miracle for you. But if you operate on the goodness of God, the love of God, and knowing that He's all-powerful and He's so willing to bless you, in fact, He has already blessed you with the finished work of Jesus Christ, then by all means, my friend, believe, but shut the door from those people who are unbelieving. Amen? So, what happened here in verse 6? When the containers were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another container." And he said, "There are no more containers." And the oil stopped. Take note, my friend. God will give you as much as you can handle, as much as you can receive, as much as you still have containers to receive. So, this tells us, okay, take note, very important, that you really need to plan for success. Huh? You need to plan for prosperity. In other words, I don't know if you've experienced this. I have experienced it. I'm guilty, no, of this experience where I would think I will only plan or, you know, anticipate things, no, when I receive the blessing. But here in verse 6, okay, you will find that they were able to, of course, borrow many containers, but, no, let's say, for example, if they only borrowed 20 containers, when actually God's provision could have, if they were able to bring in 50 containers, they would have 50 containers full of oil. But because they only borrowed 20, they only have 20. Isn't that amazing? My friend, God's resources are unlimited. We are the ones who limit God. Okay? And yet God does not want to limit Himself in blessing you. So plan for success. Plan, bring in as much, no, to receive more. Believe to receive more. That's what God is saying. But if you're believing is, you know, only at this level, you will only receive also at that level. God will only bless you and give to you according to how far and how much you can believe. Isn't that amazing? So if you believe big, by God's grace, you shall enjoy and receive big also. Amen? Praise God for that. God's resources is unlimited, my friend. And so, what happened here in verse 7? Okay, Elisha told the wife, go sell the oil, pay your debt. Wow, thank you, Jesus, for that. And you and your sons can live on the rest. See? My friend, that's giving us a hint that actually the truth is, even if you say, I only have little, a jar of oil, like the wife, but when it is put in God's hand, when you follow the ways of God, when you trust God, the blessing is already there. The answer to your problem is already there. You just have to pay attention. And of course, listen. No? That's why faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of Christ. And when you hear, act on it. Follow. No? Don't be a passive Christian. Be an active Christian. Like that woman with the hemorrhage. Remember, one Sunday we shared to you that woman of with hemorrhage, bleeding. When she, when she heard about Jesus, healing the sick and the sick touching the Jesus or his garment would get healed. When she heard, she believed and she acted because she herself went to touch Jesus and she received her healing. Even if, she didn't even ask permission. She just acted on her faith. So, how much more? No, because Jesus is already in you, my friend. So, Christ in you, you don't wait for God to bless you. In fact, God is waiting for you what you will do with the power already put inside of you. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Brothers and sisters, you have no reason not to be successful. You have no reason not to enjoy life to the full, not to have victory in every area of your life. No reason, my friend, because Christ is already in you, filled with power and authority that's already given to you. Praise God for that. Amen. And so, you see this, my friend, for somebody who is in Christ, who is doing the will of God, the ways of God, you shall experience fullness of life. Amen? And please, people are asking God for, blessing. And I know what they mean. No? They're asking for, provision, for money, for wealth. I don't know if they've read Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. No, I'll show you what it says here. But you are to remember the Lord your God, for it is He who is giving you power to make wealth in order to confirm His covenant which He swore to your fathers as it is this day. Did you see the underlined phrases there? Friends, He is giving you what? Wealth? No. Money? No. Food? No. He is giving you power to make wealth. Wow. He's not giving you wealth, my friend. He's giving you power to make wealth. So, what does that mean? You generate the wealth because He has given you the power to make it. And is He giving you this power because you begged Him? Or because you prayed and asked Him? Or because you're obedient? Or because, you're very intelligent? No. Look at here. In order, the reason for giving you this power is in order to confirm His covenant. He made a covenant. He gave His word. And now, okay, take note. This is just still in the old covenant, my friend. Deuteronomy chapter 8 is in the Old Testament, still in the Old Covenant. How much more in the New Covenant? Okay? So, before I go to the New Covenant, the New Testament, with Christ already in the picture, take note of this. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. If you want, you can memorize that. God gives you power to make wealth. You don't ask for wealth. You use the power God has given you and make your wealth. Wow! So, again, if you think you're not yet satisfied with your situation right now, that's exciting, my friend. Because now you know. If you're not satisfied, if there's still more that you want, and actually, it's insatiable, no? We cannot fully satisfy ourselves. Yes, we may be content, no? And content for a moment, but we know that there's more. And of course, no, that's not bad because God has more for us. And yet, use, no? What is already given. Because here, the power is already in us. And you use that power, make wealth, and increasingly you make wealth. Whatever situation you may have today, whatever state of life you may be in today, there's more for you, my friend. And so, that being said, let me go now to the new covenant where Christ is involved, okay? And I'll show you what happened in Matthew chapter 14, where you will find that Jesus multiplied the bread, remember? Okay, I'll show that to you. Let me read to you verses 15 to 21, Matthew 14. Now when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This place is secluded and the hour is already past to eat. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." But Jesus said to them, "They do not need to go. You give them something to eat." Whoa! Did you notice that? God is asking them, "Why don't you provide?" And what was their answer? Verse 17. They said to him, "We have nothing here except 5 loaves and 2 fish. Oops, sounds familiar. "We have nothing here except 5 loaves and 2 fish. Just like the wife, right? Very few. Verse 18, look here. Jesus said, no? "Bring them here to me." Okay, before we continue to verse 19, take note, my friend. In the old covenant, in the new covenant, in the New Testament, whatever little you have, bring to Jesus. Okay? So, you still have something to do. Huh? The Word of God is not changing things, no? The law of faith is the same. When you believe, act on it, do something. Like in the Old Testament, no, the wife was instructed, she followed. In the same way, there are things to follow, no, in the new covenant. So, what happened? Jesus was asking, "Okay, what do you have?" And here, they said, "We have nothing," no? When Jesus said, "Give something to eat," give them something to eat. Verse 17, "We have nothing except 5 loaves and 2 fish. But what did Jesus say? Bring them here to me. And in verse 19, and ordering the crowd to sit down on the grass. Okay, did you notice something? Ordering. There must be order, okay? Ordering the crowds to sit down on the grass. He, Jesus, took the 5 loaves and 2 fish and looked up. Okay, toward heaven, looked up now. What happened in the looked up here? Jesus looked up in thanksgiving. Jesus gave thanks. Okay, so one of the one way, no, to follow or to abide by the law of faith is gratitude, to give thanks. And then what happened? He, Jesus, blessed the food, and breaking the loaves, he gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate and were satisfied and picked up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 full baskets. Wow. There were about 5,000 men who ate besides women and children. Friends, what happened here? If you notice, Jesus actually here multiplied the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. Before he multiplied, what happened? Why did Jesus not, you know, like, okay, no food, okay, he will just create bread and fish immediately, no? No, he did not. what happened here? He asked for what was available. I hope you realize, brothers and sisters, God does not do magic. He will not do magic. He will not create something from nothing. That's magic. Why? Jesus makes use of what we have. Okay? I hope you understand. Because, why is that? Because, okay, very important. Take note. Listen carefully. God, no, through Jesus Christ, makes use of what we have because He wants our participation. Even in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, and now in the New Covenant, God has not changed the law of faith. What is that law of faith? That we participate, we cooperate. No? We take on what God has provided already. So in this case, 5,000 men only, no, not counting the women and the children, and yet all of them ate, and there were 12 full baskets of leftover. You will find that before Jesus multiplied or fed the 5,000 men and the women and the children, He asked for faith and participation. And that's why the disciples, no, from a child, took that 5 loaves and 2 fish. And that's how, no, from the little in God's hand, in Jesus' hand, is more than enough. Why? With more left over. Brothers and sisters, do your part. God wants you to realize that we already have what it takes to live the full and abundant life. Number one, we already have Jesus in us. Number two, in us, Jesus is power. Number three, there's already no more curse and sin and death in us because Jesus already wiped them away. So, in other words, we have all the given. We have all the ability and the resources to prosper, to succeed, and to experience miracles and abundance in our life. Brothers and sisters, God wants us to do our part, to have faith, to believe, and to act on that faith. You have little? You say, I have nothing but a little, a few, no? A jar of oil or 5 loaves and 2 fish. What's this? This is very little, my friend. No problem. Just put this, bring this to Jesus. And you will find, no? I don't know how God will work in your life, how He will prosper you, how He will let you experience healing, how He will let you experience breakthrough in every area of your life, maybe relationship, finances, health, or in your wisdom, or whatever, no? I don't know. Only God knows, no? And yet, you know how to operate now because God has revealed this to you. That, see what you have. Look around you. Don't look for that which is not available to you, no? Some people will say, if only I have been educated in this university, or if only I was able to graduate and a masteral or a doctorate degree, then I would be prosperous, I would be successful. If only I have money as a capital to do business, then I will be successful. If only I have this skill, then I will be successful, my friend. Yes, these are good things to have. But they are not determinant. They don't determine your prosperity and your success. Jesus is your success. Jesus is your prosperity. Jesus is your abundance. And all you need to do is look unto Jesus and bring the little that you have. Bring it to Him. And you will be amazed, my friend, as you meditate more on God's Word, as you listen to God and wait on Him. No? Don't panic. Don't be fearful, but wait on Him because surely, like what's happening right now, you are receiving revelation. Okay? And there's more. I mean, don't just be satisfied by with just right now revelation. No. Every day, you eat God's word. You make it like your meal every day. And meditate. No? Don't lose that revelation and forget about it during the day. No. Through the day, remember the word of God. Meditate and see how it's being applied. It's going to be applied in your situations every single hour, every day. And you will be amazed, my friend. Wisdom will flow, more revelation will flow, and God will guide you and give you knowledge and teach you and you know, show you the way to your prosperity, to your miracle, to your abundance. Because God has already provided you everything. Brothers and sisters, I hope you've been receiving this revelation, and I trust that you will really believe and apply what you have learned today. So, as we close, brothers and sisters, let me encourage you. God wants you blessed. God wants you to live the full and abundant life. God wants you to be a testimony that Jesus is truly alive in your life. Because I hope you realize also, there's so many people God wants to reach out to. Many people today who are lost, who are discouraged, who don't know what to do with their life. And God is revealing these things to you, and God is encouraging you to apply your learning, to apply the revelation, to act on your faith, no? And believe in the abundance, the prosperity, the victory, and the success that Jesus has already given you with His life, no? With His finished work. And so that your life will become a testimony, and you definitely, effortlessly, will become a blessing to many who are also lost today. Are you receiving that, brothers and sisters? I trust that you're really believing this. And I know that you will really enjoy life to the full, and you will surely be a blessing to many. Thanks be to God. So as we close, brothers and sisters, let me declare and issue command over you, because you are the blessed of the Lord. Amen? And so, you may raise your hand. I encourage you to raise your hand to receive, okay? As I make this declaration and pray over you, no? And issue command of blessing for you and even your family. Let me declare this. In Jesus' name, I declare that you are blessed, you are loved, and you are highly favored because of Jesus Christ in you. And I declare and I command every blessing, every abundance will come upon you, overtake you, because you are the blessed of the Lord. I declare that you are protected, and I declare that all evil elements around you, I command to leave you, depart from you, and stay away from you. Even sickness in your body, I command sickness and diseases to be taken from your roots and be thrown into the sea in Jesus' name. And I declare now you are healed from your sickness, from your disease. And I encourage you, brothers and sisters, to continue declaring that. And I declare also that you have abundance, that financially you shall be supplied in overflowing, so that you will have more to share to others and bless others also. That you shall have overflowing wisdom in everything you do, so that you can enjoy victory in everything that you will do. And I declare also that you are the testimony that Jesus is alive, and that people around you will see your light and be blessed by your light, and they also shall believe in Jesus Christ through you. And all these things I pray, I declare, and I command in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, I declare you're blessed. Enjoy this week, conquering things, you know, making things happen, and receiving miracle from God, and experiencing breakthrough and victory in the coming days. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you all.
Amen and amen. Were you blessed by the word today? I sure was blessed by the word today. It's a great reminder that we have the power through Jesus Christ. Amen. God has given us the power to make it all happen because of Jesus Christ. And so with that, church, before we do our closing, let's all declare this awesome declaration. I am in Christ. I am righteous because of Christ's sacrifice. I am greatly blessed, highly favored, and deeply loved. And why is that? Because Jesus loves me. Amen and amen. It's so great because today is Valentine's Day, so it's all love everywhere. Amen. 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 And so before we do our closing, let's all pray this important prayer of faith. Lord Jesus, you are my Savior. You suffered and died for me. Your wounds are for my healing. Your blood washed away all of my sins. You died, but now alive in victory. Now I can live your life of victory. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Amen and amen. If it's your first time praying that important prayer of faith, we believe that you have just received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today. And you have been restored to your original purpose as God has designed for you. Praise God. And so with that, we want to hear from you how you accepted Jesus Christ today. And if you just want to reach out to us, please head on to our Facebook page with Undeserved Favor Ministry. There you will find sermon excerpts and links to our YouTube page. Speaking of YouTube page, there you will find all the previous Sunday sermons that we have just done. And so you can rewatch all the previous sermons that we just posted on YouTube. And also please invite your friends to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Let's continue to spread God's word through our YouTube page. Amen. And so with that, we're so glad and we're so blessed to have you join us in our Sunday service today. And so, to close and prepare us all for this week, let's close with a prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this awesome day that you've given us. We thank you, Father, for the awesome word that will set us up for this week. We know, Father, that you have gone ahead of us through this week, and that by your grace, we know that we will always have the victory because of Jesus Christ. We will take responsibility and use the power that you have given us through Christ, because we are in Christ. So, Father, we just thank you and submit to you all these things. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen and amen. Praise God, church. Thank you so much for coming, joining us this Sunday. And we'll see you all next week. God bless you.